one more time. So I think this third lecture is maybe somehow the closest to problems in actual data simulation, though of course I will stay very far away from anything that is practical, but let's see what where we get. So in the last two lectures we discussed some phenomena in filtering that are actually part of the filter itself, not of the approximation, but of the filter itself, that are somehow crucial to understanding how approximations work, right? So we discussed the filter stability problem, for example. So this, let me repeat the sort of key idea from how to analyze particle filters, is that filter stability, which means that the filter forgets its initial condition, is a dissipation mechanism for approximation errors. So it's a dissipation mechanism for the accumulation of approximation errors over time, right? So even if I make an approximation, if the filter is stable, each step I make an approximation, but there is this built-in dissipation mechanism that makes the filter forget those early errors, right? So, and this is what allows us to get time uniform bounds, right? So this allows us to get time uniform error bounds rather than error bounds that grow exponentially in time. So now we saw that in high dimension we have a different problem, right? In high dimension we saw that because of the singularity of the prior and the posterior, algorithms, the particle filter algorithms, for example, just don't work. They grow, the error grows exponentially in the dimension, in the dimension of the observations, right? But somehow the exponential growth in the error is somehow very similar to the exponential growth in the error in time before we took into account filter stability, right? If we don't take into account something like filter stability, we get exponential growth of the error in time. And that can indeed happen if the filter is not stable, right? But when the filter is stable, we had to understand this fundamental mechanism. And once you have that fundamental mechanism, you can get rid of this exponential growth of the error in time, right? So now we ended up with something that's uniform in time, but it still grows exponentially in the dimension. So what you might hope is that you could do something similar as over here, and get yourself an analysis that gives you an error that doesn't grow in dimension, right? So the idea that you might have is there a spatial version, right? Is there a spatial analog of these properties? And if you have a sort of spatial, rather than having forgetting of the initial condition in time, if you have a sort of spatial notion of forgetting, maybe you can leverage that to get algorithms that don't have an error that grows exponentially in time. Right? Now, of course, there's already a crucial difference, right? Because in the filter stability case, when we didn't take into account stability, we got an error that grows exponentially in time, but the error didn't really grow exponentially in time. That was an artifact of our analysis, right? We only had to use this property, and then our analysis showed us that actually the algorithm has an error that doesn't grow in time. But the analysis of Bickel et al. Shows that that's not true for the particle filter in dimension, right? Whether or not you have a spatial version of filter stability, right, we know that the error of the particle filter grows exponentially in dimension, right? So unlike in this situation, this is not an artifact of our analysis. We will really need to change our algorithm if we want to lever. Even if you have a property like this, we will have to change our algorithm to make use of it, right? But on a fundamental level, we might try to understand these things, and on a practical level, we want to understand that if you have such properties, how do you exploit them? Okay, so that's what this lecture is going to be about. I should say at the outset that I think that a lot of the intuition that I'm going to present is somehow in the air in data assimilation. I've seen it mentioned. People use it. I've seen several talks where people mention words that are going to come back. This is the idea of localization, so we're going to see how that shows up. But you know, we're very much interested in doing this at the fundamental level, trying to understand the properties of the filter that will make this happen, trying to see if we can prove them. And on the flip side, nobody really knows how to do localization, for example, in particle filters, right? People know how to do it in ensemble common filters, which are not actually approximating the exact filter, right? So the flip side, the hope is that the theory that we develop is going to give us more intuition and more tools to develop new algorithms that we can then use to do things for real. Okay. The other thing I should mention is what I'm going to discuss today is work with my student, Patrick Ebeski. Okay. So, good. So let's start by talking about what would be a spatial analog of stability, even without the filter. What is a spatial analog of stability? Well, let's have space. So this box is space. Let's forget about time for the moment. We just have space. Right? And now we have some point V. There's some point V in space. Right? So stability in time, right? What is stability in time? If this is time, right? Then we look at time n, right? And the idea that is at time n, the state at time n doesn't depend very much at time 0, right? So the correlation between the state at time n and the state at time 0, right? Correlation is of order e to the minus lambda n, right? You have exponential stability, right? So the state at time n, the dependence of the state of time n at the state of time 0 decays exponentially, right? That's stability in time, right? So stability in space is a very similar idea, right? So what we do in stability in space is let's draw a ball around this site V, right? The ball has radius, let's say, R, right? And then we look at everything outside this ball, right? And the idea is that the dependence of X at the site V on X at the site W, if the distance between W and V is more than R, right? Is of order e to the minus lambda r. Lambda, you can take another lambda. Right? So what that means is that if I take a site, then it doesn't depend very much on all sites that are far away from it. Right? I haven't told you what dependence means. I haven't made anything precise, but this is the idea. Right? If you have such a property, this is called, in this case, exponential decay of correlations. Or I'll call it spatial mixing sometimes. So this is the natural analog of stability. Right? So it's a natural thing to expect, right? If I look at, let's talk about weather. I look at the weather here, and at the same time, right now, I look at the weather here, and I look at the weather in New York, they're probably fairly independent. It doesn't mean that over a long time period, the weather in New York might not have some effect on the weather here. But right now, the weather here in New York is probably fairly independent. However, the weather here and the weather at the Green Path Hotel is probably very similar, right? So there is some length scale lambda on which you have correlations, and outside that length scale, you have some form of decay.
True only for systems which don't have long-range.
Right. I'm not saying this is always true. This is a notion of stability, right? So we're going to say that a spatial system is stable if it doesn't have long-range correlations. Again, I haven't written down a definition, I'm just giving an idea. So exactly how you define this notion precisely will depend on how you build up your theory, right? So even if your underlying system has no long-range correlations, it doesn't mean that when you condition on the observations, there are no long-range correlations. We've already seen that problem, right? So it's not even clear if we have this property for the original system, we have it for the filter. That's the analog of the filter stability problem in the sense of spatial decay, right? But we hope that that's true, and we're going to try to exploit it. Right? So the first question you could ask is, if you have some system X which is spatially mixing, is it also true that if I condition on the observations, that it's still spatially mixing? So this is the counterpart, right? This is the spatial version of the filter stability problem. And we saw last time, we saw an example where that's not necessarily true, right? So we already know that on the one hand, this is a purely infinite dimensional phenomenon, right? You have to have space in order to speak about spatial mixing, right? So this is a question that has not really been asked in the filtering literature. I don't know any references on this, except for whatever paper that I'm talking about. But so this is not a problem that has really been considered in the filtering literature, but it's a problem that only arises in the infinite dimension, right? But we can ask the question. It's a natural spatial counterpart of the filter stability problem. We already saw last time that we have trouble, right? If we want to develop a general theory. Right? So It's not entirely clear that this is true, but on the other hand, we expect that in systems that we are actually interested in. You know, if you're a practitioner, you would expect this to be true. One would hope to be able to prove it in some setting, but this is the property we want to exploit, right? If you don't have a property like this, if you have long spatial correlations, I don't know of any way right? You will have accumulation of errors in space. I mean, it seems very hard to imagine if you do not have spatial decay of correlations, how you can end up with algorithms that are stable in the dimension. Maybe there is other properties you can exploit that I'm not thinking of, but certainly this is the most natural property, the most plausible property that would allow you to do something like that, right? So let's hope it's true, and what I'm going to talk about, so it's not really going to be much mathematics. I'm going to try to talk about how you might exploit this when you design a filtering algorithm to get yourself an algorithm whose error doesn't grow exponentially in the dimension. Well, okay, I haven't even given you a model, right? So you can set up this question also very generally, right? So later on, I'm going to write down some simple model that I'm going to work in for this lecture. Okay. Let me write it down now. So we work in a toy model here that somehow, but I think it's a nice toy model from the point of view of data simulation. So we're going to work in a Markov, so it's an infinite dimension. We're not working in infinite dimension. We're working in finite dimension here, but we want estimates that are uniform in the dimension, right? That's what you want when you're working in high dimension. So we have two directions. We have time, and we have some spatial direction. And so at each time we have some spatial points, right? Right, so there could be whatever, however many you want. Right, so here I've drawn space as being one-dimensional, but of course you can imagine space is two-dimensional or three-dimensional, whatever you want. You just, you know, I have a hard time drawing slabs out of the board, right? But so imagine it like this. So this is the Markov chain, right? So this is, for example, time n minus 1, and this is time n, and this is time n plus 1. So these are the states of the system. So this is xnv, maybe, right? So this would be xnv minus 1, maybe, xnv plus 1. And this would be xn minus 1v, et cetera, right? So you see, so these are the states. At each time, I have a random field, right? And now we have to have a dynamics. We have to have a Markov chain. And the Markov chains we're going to use are local Markov chains. So what's going to happen is that the conditional distribution of xnv given the past only depends on states in the neighborhood of the site v, right? So we're going to have a picture that looks something like this. Right? So the conditional distribution of this state given the past depends on these points, but not a point, you know, over in New York, right? But similarly, this guy, right, so this point over here depends on that point, and there's another point that comes out here, and this point, okay, you see it, right? So and similarly, we have over here, okay. So this defines a Markov chain with local dynamics. So these things have a name in the literature. They're called either interacting Markov chains or interacting particle systems, though that's usually the continuous time name. Or they're called sometimes, if you're Russian, you call them a probabilistic cellular automaton. So, okay. But these are sort of natural models of local dynamics in discrete space. Okay. And then what we're going to do is to each site, we're going to attach an observation. So here we have the sites, right? So for example, this observation would be ynv minus 1, right? And this observation over here would be yn minus 1v, et cetera. Right? So we have a sort of local dynamics of the underlying chain, right? It's a space-time system. We have a local dynamics. And to each site, or you can do it to just some subset of the sites if you want, right? It doesn't have to be to each site. But to some subset of the sites, you're going to attach local observations.
It reminds me of graphical models.
Well, I mean, you know, any picture where I draw arrows is a graphical model. But, you know, I mean, no, this is not quite graphical models in the sense that there's a direction of time here. So a graphical model, there tend to be cycles. But there are no cycles here. Right? It's a tree, right? Yeah, so, yes. Yes. No, I said not necessarily.
Not
That was one particular example, but it was a very esoteric example.
One example.
Right.
But here, introducing
right, exactly. Because you probably don't care very much about the model where each state is independent. You know, if you model the weather by just noise, you're probably not going to get very good estimates, right? So you want some dynamics if you want a theory that's not, you know, that's of some interest, right? But here we have local observations, which does make a difference, right? So before we observed on the derivatives, right? I'm not doing that here, though, you know, you could take that into account as well, right? No, the assumptions will be on the original model. But we're going to have to develop a machinery to prove. So last time I showed you that things can go wrong. I didn't say things will go wrong. I said things can go wrong if you engineer a nasty model, right? But here in these models, what we're going to do is we're going to impose assumptions that make everything go through, not just qualitatively, but we're going to get very sharp quantitative estimates for the decay of correlations. And we need them. You know, if you want to work with algorithms, you can't just say, well, this converges or that converges. I mean, you need to have sharp quantitative estimates. So we're going to have to introduce conditions that are sharp quantitative estimates. And the way, but you know, I didn't even really want to talk about this because it sort of goes beyond the scope of the lecture. But we have to make strong assumptions to get sharp to get strong quantitative information, right? So the strong assumptions are going to be that each of these local transition kernels is sufficiently mixing. So. We can discuss afterwards if you like. But this is a model, this is our stylized model in which we work. So it's a little bit of a toy model, but on the other hand, I think that this model captures more or less the main difficulty of real data simulation systems in the sense that it's a model, it's high dimensional, right? It's a random field at each time. Dynamics are local, right? Observations are local. And you could view this, for example, very naturally as a finite difference approximation of a stochastic PDE, right? If I take a stochastic PDE, let's say a heat equation or an Navier-Stokes equation or whatever, I take a finite difference approximation, I get exactly something that looks like this, right? So it's not all that far-fetched, this model. Right? But it is still a toy model in a sense. But I mean, this model, I think, does capture most of the, the features of an actual data simulation. So these are the models we're going to work in. And now you can say, well, you know, maybe if I fix at some time n, I look at xn, right? But I condition on all the observations from time 1 to time n. And now I want to know whether the conditional distribution, so I'm just looking at one slice at one time in space, I want to know whether it's mixing. But I also haven't told you what mixing means, right? So you could use different, you know, you could use different definitions. And what we're using is basically what comes out of the techniques, right? We're using certain mathematical techniques that come from statistical mechanics, and we're using whatever is convenient from that point of view, in some sense, right? So. Okay. Good. So how are we going to exploit this, right? So no matter whether or not it's mixing, spatially mixing, we know that if you run a particle filter on this thing, it's not going to work. It's going to grow exponentially in the dimension of the observations. So we want to get rid of these observations. So there's a natural way to do this, and this is really the idea of localization, which people already in data simulation are applying, right? So the idea is something like this, right? So x at time n is a random field, right? And y at time n is also some random field. Okay. Let's assume we have an observation on each site for simplicity. Okay. But you see, and we want to compute the conditional distribution, for example, of the site V given y1 to yn. Right? So we take all of the observations, but let's say we want to have local, right? We want to know the weather here, right? So we want to understand what is going on over here given all the observations. Right? So this is not going, if you run a particle filter on this, it's not going to work. Right? But remember, x and v, right, is approximately, right? Is approximately independent of sites outside, right? Of sites, certainly of the observations, right? Where the distance between V and W is more than R, right? If I look at sites very far away, right? So if I look at sites very far away, by the spatial mixing, they will be more or less independent. So also, if I have observations out here, it will be more or less independent, right? And this is up to an error of order e to the minus lambda r. Right? So what we expect, again, you would have to make these things precise, but we roughly speaking expect that if we don't condition on all the observations, but we only condition on observations in the neighborhood of v, right, then we don't lose very much because the distant observations don't carry any information about x and v. So it's approximately equal to the law of x and v, given only y1 w to yn w, where a distance between w and v is less or equal r. Right? Up to an error of order e to the minus lambda r. So we just cut the observations. We, you know, if we want to know what the weather is over here, right, let's try to condition only on observations in some neighborhood of this point. Right? Now, this introduces an error, but we hope that the error is small, right, because of the decay of correlations.
Would you make R a function of n?
Give me some time. What I'm doing here is not useful, but let's do it one step at a time. So here I'm looking, the problem what I'm doing here is I'm looking at one site V, which is not a good idea because I have to understand what the dynamics is doing somewhere else in order to understand how things move over time, right? So this is not a good idea, what I'm saying, but it's going to be the intuition, right? So the idea is if I care about the point V, I just should use observations in the neighborhood of V, right? This introduces an error which should be small, right? But now the idea is that this object, yes.
The error will be e to minus r lambda r times some factor which will depend on k minus n. K and n are the temporal coordinates.
Where is k?
Y1 through yn, the yk. So ykw. So you said that.
But remember, it's also stable. So also, if I go backwards in time, it doesn't depend too much. So these errors don't accumulate over time. Right, so I'm not going to do it exactly like this anyway, okay. So this approximation has an error of e to the minus lambda r. There's no algorithm yet, right? I've just approximated the filter in some sense by another filter, right, with less information. But now this guy I can approximate by a particle filter, but it's not the particle filter based on this conditional distribution. It's the particle filter where I only condition on observations in the neighborhood. Right? But remember, this has an error. What is the error? It's 1 over square root n. And on top is exponential in the dimension of the observations. But the dimension of the observations here is not all of the observations. It's just the size of this ball. Right? So it's the exponential of the size of the ball around v of radius r. So the dimension of the full system no longer appears. Right? So the idea is that the local error, if I do this type of procedure, the local error should be something like e to the minus lambda r plus e to the however large a ball is of radius r divided by square root n, right? And this term you call the bias, and this term is the variance term, or the sampling error. This is a back of the envelope calculation, right? So now the dimension doesn't appear, but the only thing that appears is the size of the neighborhood that I've chosen in my algorithm. And I'm allowed to choose this r however I want, right? So if I choose this r to be the full dimension of the system, I get the original particle filter, and I have here something that depends on the full dimension of the system, right? But if I choose my r, but I'm not going to do that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to optimize this bound over r, right? And when I optimize this bound over r, the original dimension disappears, and I get something that the error goes to zero. So just for example, let's do an example. Suppose I'm really in this setting where I have one-dimensional space, right? So if I have one-dimensional space, the size of a ball of radius r is just r, or 2r plus 1 or something, right? So we have here e to the minus r, and here we have e to the r, right? So to optimize between these two things, I need to choose r to be about log n, log of the sample size. Sorry, this is log big n, right? Sorry, sample size. Right? So for example, right, if v is one-dimensional, right, then I should choose r to be something like log of the sample size. Right? And if I choose r to be log of the sample size, then the total error will be a polynomial small n, right? It won't be 1 over square root n. It will be something 1 over n to the beta, right, with some beta smaller than 1/2. But it will, the error will go down polynomially, and in particular, the dimension no longer appears. It's a completely dimension-free problem, right? I've completely taken out the dimension because the only the observations that show up in this problem are inside a ball of radius r. So I can pick r however I want. So by doing this, I've gotten rid of the dimension completely, and we have a local error which goes to zero uniformly in the dimension. So this is somehow the basic back of the envelope computation that we want to do. Right? This is what we hope to do, what we hope to achieve. We're going to approximate the filter. First, we're not going to directly approximate the filter by a particle filter. We're going to approximate the filter by a different object that only uses local observations. And then we're going to approximate that object by a particle filter. And we have to control, so we make a bias error, we make a systematic error by neglecting observations, right? But on the other hand, we win enormously when we look at the variance of the Monte Carlo filter. And now we have to balance between those two things, and that basically comes down to choosing a correct radius of which we cut off the observations. And the correct radius is going to depend, obviously, on the number of particles that we choose, right? So the more particles we take, the larger of a radius we can take in this algorithm in order to get a small error. So is this intuition, there's lots of things wrong with this which I'm going to discuss, but is the intuition what we want to achieve is clear, right? We want to do this computation, right? Okay, so the volume of the ball, there are two dimensions, right? So when we say the dimension of the model, when we talk in filtering about the curse of dimensionality, we mean the number of points in the spatial grid. Right? So we have a grid in space, and the number of points is the dimension of the filter, right? Because a random field, you see, a random field indexed by a set V is just an element, let's say, of R to the V, right? So in the filter, when we talk about dimension, we mean the number of grid points, right? But there's a different dimension here, which is what is the topology of the neighborhood that we're using to define the local dynamics, right? So for example, I could take...
It's like a network.
Right, so what is the degree of this graph? That's an entirely different story, right? Okay, so let me give an example, right? So I could have... My sites, right, the spatial points could be a line of size, let's say, R, right? Right, so I could have them. And what this means is that when I have the dynamics, and each time the value of this point depends on its two neighbors in the previous time, right? So let's say I take 2 to the R of these, right? Let's do R squared, right? But I could take R squared, so 5 is not a square. So let's take 9 of them. Right, so this could be a line, right? But I could also take a 3x3 block, right? So these two grids have the same number of points, right? But they're going to mean something else for the dynamics of the model, right? Because the way we've constrained the dynamics is that the dynamics at each point in the previous times are dependent on its neighbors. But this guy, this point has 4 neighbors, but this point only has 2 neighbors, right? But they're the same number of points in the two grids, right? So in the filtering problem, when I say that the particle filter grows exponentially in dimension, what I mean by dimension is the number of points in the grid. So that would be the same for these two, right? But here, there is another dimension, which is basically the neighborhood structure, right? So in these two cases, you get a different scaling over here, right? In this case, this is e to the r, but in this case, this would be e to the r squared. In which case you would need to take r to be of order square root log n, right, to make it work out. So there are two different dimensions, so it's a little bit confusing. But there's no hope whatsoever to avoid the curse of dimensionality in the dimension in this sense, right? I mean, if I have a PDE on RP, and I let P go to infinity, I mean, this is always going to be, even simulating the PDE is going to be, grow exponentially in the dimension, right? So there's no hope of ever avoiding the curse of dimensionality in this sense, right? The problem that we have is that we have a big spatial extent, right? So that's the issue here, right? But there are these two different dimensions, so you have to be a little bit careful. So when I wrote here in 1D, I meant this as opposed to that, not that I just have one point in my grid, which is not a very interesting filtering problem. Did I clear it up? Okay. Are there any more questions? Okay. So this is the idea. All right. So we want to achieve this, right? So really, this is what we're going to do. We're going to approximate the filter by something else, which only uses, at each point, local observations. And then that something else we're going to approximate by a particle filter. And then we have to use decay of correlations to quantify the bias term. And then we have to use the just Monte Carlo analysis to quantify the variance term. But the beauty of the variance term is it's now only going to depend on the size of the neighbor. And then you have to balance those two things. Now, what's the problem? So here I said, well, I made life very easy, right? Because I said, OK, I fix a point V, one site V, and I'm just going to condition on observations in the neighborhood of V, right? So I approximated the filter by another filter. But this is a very useless approximation, because this only works at the point V, right? But this can never work very well, because we're throwing out all observations everywhere else, right? So, you know, I mean, we know, for example, think about weather systems move, right? So, you know, if I'm throwing away observations, you know, everywhere outside a 50-kilometer radius from here, I'm going to lose a lot of information, right? And I'm only going to get something at the point V, right? So this is not a very good thing. What we want to do is we want to do something like this simultaneously at all points V, right? But it's clear I can't do that by approximating the filter by another filter, right? I mean, somehow or other, I have to come up with an algorithm that at each point V only uses the local observations around that point to condition, but it has to be the true for each point V, right? And it's not at all obvious how to do that, right? I mean, I say that's what I want, right? The intuition is sort of clear, right? At each point V, I want my algorithm to just use local observations. But how am I going to set up this algorithm in a way that it converges to the actual filter? I mean, it's not clear, right? So I can have dreams as much as I want, but I'd have to provide you with an algorithm that actually makes this precise, because this is not going to work, right? So the problem one is it's not even clear how to even define an algorithm that makes sense. Right? An algorithm that satisfies this idea at every point V. So we already, I mean, we have an intuition, but we don't know how to implement it. Right? In common filters, it's trivial, right? Because you have a covariance matrix. But yes. But the Gaussian approximation is not going to converge anyway to the filter. So, you know, we're trying to do this in a systematic way. Yes, so. Okay. Okay. But you have to be careful, because you see the assumption I made here is that conditionally on the field, the observations, the noises are independent. This was the model assumption I have over here, which makes sense in the discrete case. But in the continuous case, that doesn't really make much sense, right? Because, right, so if you want to go to continuum, you can no longer take, you have to have some sort of smoothness, right? So you cannot take them to be independent. So in that case, if you make the observations finer and finer, you probably will get a local density still, even though you have an infinite dimensional local observation, but it'll have a density, right? So the problem here is the lack of density, but that really requires infinitely many sort of independent degrees of freedom. And in your situation where you make it finer and finer, you get more and more and more observations in count, but you don't get more and more independent degrees of freedom, because eventually you'll be beneath the correlation length of the noise, and then everything will be okay. So, you know, okay. You can't generalize these things too much, but I think that's sort of the answer to the question that you get. Okay. So that's problem one. We don't even, I mean, I wrote it down, doesn't mean it makes sense, right? The second problem is that if you go look in the literature, we have no tools to understand these problems, right? I mean, right, we want to understand these types of approximations, but these are high-dimensional problems, right? We need to have bounds that have explicit dependence on the dimension, that don't grow on the dimension. They have to be uniform in time. You know, we need tools, mathematical tools, to actually do these analyses, right? So problem number two is that even if we had an algorithm that made sense, right, mathematical toolbox to analyze filter problems in high dimensions is more or less lacking. To analyze these problems in high dimension. Is largely lacking. High dimensional filtering problems. And you know, what we talked about last time was a very qualitative theory, right? But if I actually wanted to make sense of algorithms, you know, that's not enough. I need actual control, right? I need to have estimates. And you need to have a way of analyzing these conditional distributions in high dimension explicitly in terms of dependence on the dimension, right? So, okay. So, this problem is more interesting to me, but this problem is probably more interesting to you, right? So, let me talk briefly about this problem. Well, maybe I won't even write it down, I'm just going to say it. So we have basically one tool. That's the only tool I know how to use to get actual quantitative information. Right? We have much more general tools to get qualitative information of the type that we discussed last time. But there's only one tool that I have available to analyze these types of problems. And these are tools that come from statistical mechanics, but not statistical mechanics of the 2000s, but statistical mechanics of the 1970s. Okay, so it's a little bit old. So the way these things work is if you look at the model that we're discussing, right, these types of models, you shouldn't view these as a time-varying random field with local observations, right? That's sort of the filtering interpretation of this. But really, the way you should view this, and maybe this is closer to what you're saying, graphical models, you should view this in space-time as a random field. This is one big random field. And not only is it a random field, but it's a Markov random field, right? If I condition everything on this point and everything else, it just depends on its neighbors, right? So we should go away from thinking about filtering problems as filtering problems. We should view them as a type of space-time random fields where we compute conditional distributions of random fields. And in the theory of random fields, right, random fields are all about decay of correlations, looking in high dimension, what happens to distant points, et cetera. And there is a family of very, very strong tools. So this is a very heavy hammer called so-called Dobruschen contraction methods. And Dobruschen contraction methods, you have to go to your textbook on statistical mechanics. Dobruschen contraction method provides you exactly with the type of quantitative toolbox that you need or that you can use in order to get sufficiently strong estimates to prove things about high-dimensional filters. So the good news is that we have one tool that you just hit it and it works, right? It seems to work. The bad news is that it requires extremely strong assumptions to make it work. But the strong assumptions are ones that make sense at a qualitative level, right? So I can never hope to say anything sharp based on this methodology, but if we're trying to get some form of mathematical insight, at least at the qualitative level, certainly, the Dobruschen contraction methods are the right place to start. And already using these methods, it's not entirely obvious how to proceed, right? But so you do have to do a lot of analysis, but there's basically one theorem, and if you go and look in, you know, we wrote a paper about this, you go look in the paper, somewhere I just write the theorem, right? You know, so it's one theorem, and we just use it over and over and over and over and over again. So you know. But unfortunately, it's the only tool we have, and it's not very sharp, right? So. It's a very heavy hammer, but it's a very blunt hammer. You know, it's very big, so you hit it and everything else breaks too, right? So, but that's the only tool we have. So if you want to start thinking about these types of problems from a mathematical point of view, I would start there. But certainly more machinery. To get much further, you really need to develop more machinery, and we don't have it at this point. Okay. All right. So that's all I'm going to say about the theory. So let's think about the algorithm. So how are we going to do this algorithm? So the problem here is that we want to do this not just at one point, but at every point. So basically, we have only one algorithm right now that we can analyze, but we have other algorithms that make much more sense, right? So, but let me tell you first about the algorithm we can analyze. So this is the simplest possible algorithm, non-trivial algorithm. And this algorithm has a lot of things wrong with it, and I don't think it's going to work very well in the type of systems that you guys are interested in. But it's the simplest possible thing you could do to make this intuition precise. And for this algorithm, we have a fairly complete analysis. Okay, so that's the nice thing. So we have at least one algorithm where we could prove the whole thing that I've been hand-waving over here. We have one algorithm for which we could prove that this is true in a precise sense. Okay. But the algorithm has something wrong with it, which you'll see immediately, or otherwise I'll discuss it in a moment. So let's look what we do. So this is space. Just two-dimensional space, let's say. And what we're going to do is we're going to take space and we're going to divide it up into blocks. So these are blocks of size R, for example. So we take space, we divide it up into blocks of size R. And now we're going to do something very simple. So we're going to run a particle filter, the ordinary particle like I discussed last time in this model, with one key difference, which is that when we weight and resample, right? So in the ordinary particle filter, we compute a weight, so we take the whole observation. For each particle, we compute the likelihood of the whole observation for that particle, and then we resample from those weights. Right? Here, what we're going to do is we're not going to do that. We're going to do that independently in each block. So for example, we start with this block. In this block, we just compute the likelihood of the observations in this block for each particle. And then we resample n times from these weights, and now we get n new samples, right? But only this block. And then we go to the next block and we repeat the same thing, but independently from each block, right? So in some sense, what we do is we pretend like the different blocks are actually completely independent of each other, right? Which is obviously not true, right? There's a correlation length lambda, or 1 over lambda here, right? So the fact that we make a sharp cut at the edges of these blocks is terrible, but this is the algorithm, right? So what we do is we take large blocks, right? And in each block, we sort of independently resample, right? So we compute just the likelihoods inside the block, which achieves what we want over here, because what happens is when we have the likelihood inside the block, the weights only depend on the dimension, right? The number of points in the block. They don't depend on the full dimension, right? So in each block, we compute independently just the weights inside the block, and then we resample independently inside each block. So you can immediately see why this is not going to be very good for physical systems, because what is happening is you're creating discontinuities on the block edges. If you're creating discontinuities on the block edges, if you have a physical system, you're probably creating shock waves that are going all over the place, right? This is beyond my area of expertise, but probably you're going to have all sorts of artifacts emanating from these edges, right? But this is the basic idea. So what does this correspond to? Well, I write algorithm, but it's not really algorithm. I'm going to write it in the notation that I had last time. So remember that the true filter by n has this recursion where I first propagate it forward, and then I weight it, right? Propagate forward, weight. That's the base formula, right? And the usual particle filter by nn is I do this and I resample by n minus 1. Anybody who was still confused by Dan yesterday can come to me after the lecture and I will explain why this is exactly the bootstrap algorithm. So this is the usual particle filter. So now let's look at the algorithm and what we do. So the algorithm, so this block particle filter, let's call it BPF, what does it do? So what it does is we do the same thing, but now we add this blocking operation. And this blocking operation, all it does is if I hit this blocking operation on the measure mu, it replaces the original measure mu by a product over the blocks of the restriction of mu to the block B. So what this operator B does is it takes a measure which has some joint distribution of all these sites, and it replaces them with the measure where every block is independent, but the marginal distribution inside this block is the same as in the original measure. Right? This is just a projection of this of the original measure onto independent blocks. Right? Is this clear? Right? So this algorithm corresponds exactly to what I just said, because you see, when you first sample, but now when you project on the blocks, it's like we have n samples and each block operate independently from each other. So then when I weight this thing and I resample, when I get the weights in each block, I just compute the weights in each block and I sample from each block separate. So this is exactly the algorithm that we have. So the whole point with this algorithm, if I let the number of particles go to infinity, it does not converge, right? And if I let the number of particles go to infinity, it does not converge to the ordinary filter, right? It converges to the filter with this extra blocking step inside, which is not the true filter, right? So we can have this pi tilde n. Let's define pi tilde n to be this guy without the sampling, right? So if I let the number of particles go to infinity while keeping the blocks fixed, pi tilde nn will converge to pi tilde n, right? But pi tilde n will converge to the exact filter if I make the blocks larger and larger, right? So the way you do the analysis is you say, well, the true filter minus this approximation, I could split the error into two terms. First, I look at the error that is caused just by introducing the blocks. And then I look at the error between this block filter and its particle approximation. Right? So this term will go to zero as the number of samples will go to infinity. And this term will go to zero as the size of the blocks goes to infinity. So this term, again, this is the bias. This is the variance. And if you do the analysis, you actually get a bound. So this is something like, the bias will be something like e to the minus lambda times the distance. OK, so now I have to make an error. So the error that I'm using here is going to be local, right? So I cannot take the global error everywhere. I need, just in the, as in this analysis, I need to look at the error locally at different sites, right? So I'm going to attach to these norms a set j. So j is a subset of the sites, right? And the norm J, right, is just the norm of the restriction of this to the set J. Right? So this is the error between the marginals of these two measures on the set J. Right? So here what we're going to do is we're going to take a J that's a subset of one of these blocks. Right? So this is the block B. And J is going to be some subset of a block B. OK, J is subset of a block B. Right. So here we're going to get something that's the distance from the set J and the complement of the block B. Right. Because you see, if I'm over here, right, I'm making an error on the boundaries of these blocks. Right. So what's the smallest error? Well, that's the shortest distance from the set J to the boundary of the block. And here, for the variance, we get something like e to the power of the size of the block, because what do? We condition in each block on the observations in that block. And the number of observations in the block is just the cardinality of the number of points in the block. Right? And here we get our usual 1 over square root n Monte Carlo rate. Here is another constant. And there are constants sitting in front. So this is somehow making precise the intuition we had over here. And this is a theorem. Theorem under local mixing assumptions that ensure that the system actually has the decay of correlations that we need. Right? That's not something we assume. That's something we have to prove. Right? And that's one of the major difficulties of this story is you have to prove everything from scratch. You start with a model. Right? So it's not enough to say, well, you know, we're going to use the decay of correlations of the filter. You have to prove that the filter has the decay of correlations. So we have to prove everything that goes into this, and it takes a little while. But you know, you have one tool, which is the Ruchin contraction method, and you use it over and over again. So, okay. So now you have something like this. Well, what are you going to do? Well, this term gets larger as the blocks get larger, but this term gets smaller as the blocks get larger, right? So you're going to optimize over the size of the blocks, and then you're going to get something where the error goes to zero as n goes to infinity. So this is as far as we have finished theory. Okay, so Now, what is wrong with this algorithm? So we already discussed physically what's wrong with this algorithm, right? This algorithm has these boundaries, and we're sort of creating nasty stuff happening at these boundaries. There's a more concrete way of seeing this problem. Right? You see, the error here, the error on the set J depends from the distance of J to the boundary. So if I take a point on the boundary, right, this error is not going to go to 0. The error is going to be of order 1, right? Because I'm always creating lots of errors on the boundary. Now, as I make the blocks larger and larger, there'll be less and less points on the boundaries, right, or close to the boundaries, right? So what do we can prove using these methods, right? So this method gives me a small error for points sort of on the interior of the block, right? If we take some interiors of these blocks, right? So what our result shows is that for the points in the interiors sort of these blocks, you get errors going to 0 uniformly in the dimension, right? And as you make the blocks larger and larger, the fraction of points in the space that lies in the interior of the blocks goes to 1, right? So what this is saying is that for most points in the space, the error will be small. But it's very spatially inhomogeneous, right? You create these artificial boundaries where you make errors, and you never get rid of that. All you hope for is that when you make the blocks larger and larger, there'll be less and less boundaries. But if you're sitting on the boundary, you will always be making lots of errors, right? So this is somehow an unsatisfactory algorithm. It's an unsatisfactory way of doing things, because it's creating these artificial boundaries where things sort of do not work well, right? So in some sense, we're cheating when we're doing this, right? What we're doing is if you look at one block, right, the approximation will be good for that point, but the approximation will not be good for that point, because even for this point, we condition on the observations in this block, right? So we're losing these observations over here that are very close to that point, right? And that's not really what you want to do. Ideally, what you want to do is when you take this point, right, this is the same picture, right? When you take this point, you want to condition on observations in some neighborhood around that point. But when you're looking at this point, you want to condition on some observations around that point, right? You want these observation patches to overlap in some sense. Whereas when we introduce this partition, we introduce the fixed partition with these fixed artificial boundaries. And even for that point, we're just conditioning on the observations inside this set, right? So we're now allowing our sets of observations to overlap. So this is really the core of the unsatisfactory nature of this argument, right? This is such a simple algorithm that we were able to do something, but from a practical point of view, this has a lot of drawbacks, right? This is not a very nice way to do localization. So ideally, you want to do this, and then the question becomes, how do you do that? I mean, it's not at all obvious how to do that.
Right?
Yes. The full norm you will never, ever be able to get, but the full norm is a very, very stringent object, right? So the full norm says that you get, if the full norm is small, that means that you approximate every, you know, spurious correlation in the system. You know, if you wanted to approximate the correlation between the weather here and the weather in New York, right, you know, you would have to take into account exactly everything, you know, that's going on in the system. This is a very hard thing to approximate. There is no way you're ever going to do that, right? Even the Markov chain itself is not going to converge in the full norm in high dimension. And this is a known property of high-dimensional systems, right? So in infinite dimension, for example, total variation norm is, forget it. It's not going to be, it's always going to be 2. All measures are mutually singular. Total variation norm is always 2. And, you know, you're not going to get convergence. So one of the things you need to do when you work in high dimension is you need to measure the errors locally. And this is an idea that's very prevalent in all analysis in high dimension. I mean, you know, not just in filtering, but if you're interested even in any high dimensional model, you need to do this type of idea. Right? The other way that people think in high dimension is by working with weak convergence rather than working with total variation convergence. But that comes down more or less to the same thing. But that is something I would have to explain to you. But working with weak convergence instead of total variation more or less comes down to looking at local functions. So this is crucial. Yeah, you have to measure the error in the right way, right? But what doesn't necessarily need to be the case, right? What's the case over here that doesn't need to be the case is that the error depends on where the set J is, right? So ideally, we would get an error. I didn't draw it here, but this whole thing is multiplied by the cardinality of the set J. Right? So the larger of a set J I take, the worse is my estimate, but in a sort of proportional way, right? But ideally, what I want is I want to get an error. Of course, it will always grow if I look at larger and larger sets because I have more and more correlations I need to approximate well, right? So they'll always grow if I look at larger and larger sets. But ideally, I want an algorithm where the estimate will not depend on where in space the set J is, right? So the error will be just as small over here as over there. But this algorithm does not have that. This algorithm, depending on where the set J is, the error might be very large or very small. Right? And what you want to have is a localization algorithm that is sort of uniform or homogeneous in space. It's not clear how to do it. However, the theory suggests an algorithm. And how long do I have? 5 minutes. Okay. We have an alternative algorithm that really resolves this problem in the sense that conceptually it resolves this problem. Okay. And it really does this in some sense. Around each point, it uses the observations around the point to estimate that. And around that point, it uses the observation around this point. It's a very natural algorithm. And the form of the algorithm is actually motivated by the theory we developed to prove this result. So once we develop the proof, the way that in which in this proof we have to quantify the decay of correlations in order to do the proof already suggested how to modify the algorithm to get it to look like this. Unfortunately, so I can very hand-wavily tell you what it is, but it will be much easier to do if I write down equations for which I don't have the time. But this algorithm is much harder to analyze. And we have been working on it. Well, to be completely precise, Patrick has been working on it. And we have quite a bit of theory preliminary results for this thing, but we're stuck on some technical issues. So I'm hoping this will be resolved. But certainly the theory that's there is already, it very convincingly shows that this other algorithm that we have actually does what we think it does. But yeah, there are some hurdles to be overcome, and the theory is much harder than over here because of various reasons. But okay. But just very vaguely how this algorithm works is that, you see, what's the core idea of this algorithm? We need to localize. So we need to make sure that at each point you use local observations. And the way in which we localize is to introduce a projection into the algorithm. In this case, we project it onto independent sets B, right? And what this projection does is it makes sure that when you actually sample, the sampling process automatically takes into account this local structure. Right? So you should think of this projection as a sort of regularizer, right? It's a way of regularizing the algorithm. Even though the sampling kills the decay of correlation, the projection brings back the decay of correlation. Right? So the other algorithm that we have doesn't use a projection on blocks, but it has a different way of regularizing the algorithm. And what it does is, in some sense, it projects the system not on independent blocks, but it projects the system on Markov random fields with a certain size of the spatial dependence. Right? So instead of saying that this block is independent of that block, what we're saying is that for each point, for each point V, the conditional distribution of that point V, given all the other points, we truncate it to be in some neighborhood size R. So we truncate somehow the conditional probabilities of these points. So when you do this, you approximate the original random field, which is not Markov. The marginal of a Markov random field is not Markov. You approximate it by a Markov random field of order R. And when you approximate this by a Markov random field of order R, you wait and you sample. You can use something like a Markov chain Monte Carlo method, a Gibbs sampler, to sample from that distribution. And the Gibbs sampler locally only uses, at each point, only uses weights that sit inside this radius R. And so this is how the system works. So in some sense, what you do is you sample a bunch of particles, right? You propagate them forward. And then you truncate this, and then you run a Gibbs sampler on this truncated distribution. in space. So it's not a Gibbs sample. It's not Markov-chain Monte Carlo in time, in space-time. But in each step of the filtering algorithm, you run a Markov-chain Monte Carlo algorithm just in space to sample from the next distribution. Then you propagate forward, and you use a Markov-chain Monte Carlo algorithm to sample in space from the next distribution. But this Markov-chain Monte Carlo algorithm would fail miserably if you didn't do anything to this. You have to do something like this truncation in order to make that Markov-chain Monte Carlo algorithm work. But the exact details I would really have to write down, and I don't have time to go there. But this is somehow this idea of truncating the conditional distributions is actually something we're already using in the proof of this result. And so the theory already suggests that you should be doing something like that. And all we did was, once we were using these types of techniques in the proof, we just decided, well, let's stick it in the algorithm, and it gives you something very natural. But OK, I wish we could prove it. I think we will eventually prove it, but it's not quite there yet. So maybe I should finish. I gave you several open problems. And in the setting of this, one very natural open problem is, you know, localization has been done in data simulation literature in the common filter, right, in the ensemble common filter. And of course, if you have a common filter, it's much easier. All these problems I have over here of how do you build the algorithm don't really arise, right? Localization in common filters is a very easy thing because all you have to do is truncate the covariance matrix in some sense of the that you have. So in the setting of common filters, how to truncate is not really the issue. But to my knowledge, there is no theory whatsoever about this. Right? So we actually have, you see, we have sort of a, we have a whole process by which we analyze these types of problems. Right? Really, the analysis we do here sort of should give guidance to how to analyze these types of problems. Right? You have to establish decay of correlations, and you have to split up the thing into a bias and a variance term. Right? So in some sense, if you had ensemble common filter with localization, you should do two things. First, you should control the error between the ensemble common filter of localization and the true common filter with localization, right? Where you don't sample, right? But it's just the true common filter, but you're localizing the true common filter, right? And then you need to control the error between the localized true common filter and the common filter without localization, right? And so one problem that there would be, which I think would be a nice problem for somebody to look at, is to actually repeat this type of analysis in the setting of the ensemble common filter, which seems to be used very widely, and to establish similar type of...
So the notion of a projection is not intuitive and clear in this case, but the Markov random case,
yeah.
It's not clear what you're trying to...
In fact, we don't. I mean, I'm cheating. So what we do is the following. What we do is we take the conditional distribution of the filter at a point given all the other points. Okay. This depends on the whole, on everything. It's not a Markov random field. Right? And at each point, we take that conditional distribution, which you can compute, and you truncate it to a neighborhood. Right? So and then what you would like to do is you would like to say, now what we do is we sample from the random field that has those truncated distributions as their conditional distributions. But as you might realize, such a random field does not exist. Because once you do the truncation, the conditional distributions are no longer compatible with each other. Right? So what we do is we say, well, OK, so a random field doesn't exist, but it doesn't stop us from running a Gibbs sample.
But the distribution may not be exact. The sampler puts out something.
It's not a Markov random field, no, what it puts out. Right? So all of the analysis is done at the level of the Gibbs sampler, and that's why it becomes nasty, because you can no longer use this machinery that we used over here. The machinery we use is based on the space-time structure of the problem. But once you go to Markov chains, there's a very clear direction of time. You have to do everything one-sided. And when you do things one-sided, OK, this is becoming fast a tricky story. So the analysis becomes much more tricky. But we're analyzing a Gibbs sampler, but for a distribution that doesn't exist, right? So we're doing a Gibbs sampler with a set of conditional distributions that do not add up to act. They're not compatible with any big distribution. But that doesn't stop you from running a Gibbs sampler, right? And the idea is that the output of this Gibbs sampler, after n steps, n being large enough to control the error, so now what you do is you look how long you have to run this as compared to the, you know, to make the error from the Gibbs sampler smaller than the error from the bias and the error from the variance, right? So. But yes, it's a tricky business. So we don't really project onto Markov random fields. In the end, we sample from something that's not a Markov random field. But this is the guiding intuition for the analysis. Yes. Oh.
Sorry,
you were first. Yeah. Yes.
But does, would that fix the sort of physical stitching together?
I mean, I didn't have a chance to really explain what we do. The stitching is done by the Gibbs sampler. So maybe it's better if I do this on the board because, you know, it will take another 10, 15 minutes for me to go through it, yes.
Yeah.
But yeah. One way to think about it is you're doing a sort of resampling in space rather than in time, right? And you keep doing this for a few times. And you do it locally, so this somehow stitches together all the points. But yeah, I think it's better if we write it on the board. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Yes. Okay. Yeah. You had one more question?
Yeah.
Yes. But how long is long? How long is long?
It depends.
Okay.
If you are talking about, let's say, mid-atmosphere synoptic perturbation, they can be even on the order of hundreds of kilometers. If you are talking about convective scale due to the strong evaporation, I'm talking about below 1 kilometer. So one problem that we have is the problem that we have to be able to track these time-dependent spatial correlation.
So one thing about, okay, so when you do the theory of this, I mean, I said here blocks of size R, but that's not written in the theory. These are any partition of the space we can use, in principle. In this, but this algorithm is terrible anyway. No, but the same would hold over here, right? The same would hold over here with this other algorithm that I didn't explain. You can pick other types of truncations. I mean, nothing here depends on the shape of what we're doing, right? But that being said, the theoretical tools that we have to understand these systems are very, very far from having, you know, there's no hope of being able to capture this phenomenon in simple, at least in, you know, in any form of generality. So, you know, none of the theory relies on the one hand, none of the theory relies on the exact shape of these things as long as they're growing with the sample size that you're using the particle filter. But you know, so there's no restriction to these shapes in some sense, but we also not capturing theoretically the phenomenon that you're describing. We certainly do not have the tools to capture that phenomenon and be able to see that that is better than taking any other shape that's growing. So, you know, so of course, when you do this in real life, you have to tune it very carefully and to make it work. And practical things that I have little hope of proving anything about will start playing an important role, and that's where the intersection between the you know, between the theory and the practice becomes very important, right? So but yeah, this was an example in the sense with these square blocks. Nothing here relies on these blocks being square or evenly shaped or isotropic, but we will never see, I mean, I have here a distance, we will never see this anisotropy in some sense, particularly if it's time varying. We won't see it in the way that we do these proofs. Okay, so yes, The same holds for the other algorithm. You can truncate however you want as long as it grows in some sense. What matters, one thing that I didn't emphasize is when I said this, so what I wrote in my bound was the size of the block. But I believe the only thing that matters is the number of observations in the block. If the observations are sparse, so in the model that we did, we assumed that every point had an observation attached to it, which are dense observations, right? If the observations are sparse, I haven't checked the analysis very carefully, and we do crude things throughout the analysis that, you know, can probably be avoided if you do them more carefully. But what I would expect is that what matters is the number of observations in each block, which might be a lot less than the size of the block, right? So even if your block is 100 kilometers in length, it really what really matters is how many weather stations you have in some sense inside that. So yeah, I didn't make that distinction in the